My regular glasses, my spare for what it's going to get it back tomorrow. Even that is too late for me, the text there.
Oh.
And this is my spare reading glass.
I'll read it.
No, no, I mean, I can just about read that. Ye to bilkul nahi pad rahi. Ah, the ye glasses ki zarurat hai. That I can read.
Hmm.
Just trying to see how bad my vision is. Okay, I think it's starting. Okay, good morning everyone, and welcome to this live interaction of the NPTEL course on designing learner-centric e-learning in STEM disciplines. I'm Sahana Murthy, the instructor of this course, and we are joined by a couple of our course team members, Dr. Vinita Shah and Sunita Raste. So I think we can get started with the interaction. Neeta?
Yeah. So we will, I'm going to present a screen. So. Is it visible? Okay.
Yes, it is.
Okay, great. So, I can't see anything.
You might have to go to your screen.
Yeah. Anyways, one second.
This is a problem in Google Meet.
A window, let's say. The download. Okay, so here is the process that we will follow. We will start answering the queries that we have already received from our Google form. And this is going to be an interactive session, so feel free to ask your questions, to interact. Ask your questions on the live chat. And other participants, please feel free to pitch in to questions asked by your peers. But do make clear to as to what which question are you answering. And if there is some time, then we will follow some of the interesting conversations, open questions that have been there on the discussion forum. So let's start with our questions that we have received. So the first question has been by faculty Jitendra Gajbe, who has asked that in week one LXT, can we solve all quizzes? Is that going to affect my progress or marks? So no, it is not going to affect anything. Please go ahead and attend take all the quizzes of all the LXTs. And the best quiz will be taken for grading. So feel free to explore all the LXTs and quizzes. The second question is from a student, Manakau, who is asking about some of the Android supporting software that can be used for creating learner-centric e-content. So our team has prepared some software list for you. So Sunita, can you probably provide a gist?
Sure. Thank you, Vinita ma'am. So to answer the question which was raised by Manakau, it is a very valid question that many students, they use Android phones to access the course material which has been uploaded by the teacher instead of laptop. There could be many reasons. You don't have access to laptop or you have shared devices and you end up using your mobile phones because they are very handy. So here are some tools or softwares which can be used on an Android device. And depending upon the purpose that you want to achieve, we have divided the softwares or tools, we have categorized those. So say, for example, if you want to develop an interactive video or an interactive image, which has to be sent to the students. So for that purpose, you can use H5P, which is an open source software, which can also be accessed from your mobile phone. You just have to switch to the desktop view on your mobile phone, and you'll be able to access the different options which are there in H5P. Another similar option or a similar website which is available is Geniali, which gives you an option of creating interactive images. You can add hotspots to the images, you can add certain instances of interaction, and you can create an interactive image. Another option or an Android app which can be used for this purpose is Liveboard Interactive Whiteboard app. Now, this is a whiteboard app where you can create your whiteboard, you can draw diagrams, you can explain theorems of mathematics, you can also upload the files, you can create different groups, and you can share those groups with a group of students who can join those. It also provides an inbuilt screen recording option. So as and when you're using a whiteboard and explaining the different options or different content, you can record it at the same time and you can stream the same. Now, if you're using any other device or any other options for recording your screen or your slides, which you have prepared, or you want to record your screen itself to show the interactions that you're doing with a website. So for that purpose, if you're using a desktop, you can go for Camtasia or OBS Studio or even OpenShot. Or if you're using an Android phone, you can use an inbuilt screen recorder, which is available in many of the Android devices. If it is not an inbuilt option, you can always go to Play Store and download a screen recorder application, which gives you an option of recording the screen. The OpenShot also provides an application which can work on Android, so you can go for that too. If you want to create some collaborative activities for your students or for your peers, for that collaboration, you can use Padlet, which gives you an option of entering muddy points or using sticky notes to put down your points. You can also go and comment on other people's points. Miro board is another such example. And Jamboard is something that comes with your Google account. So you can use Jamboard for collaborative, where two, three people, or more than that, a group of people can collaborate together. They can edit an image together. They can comment on each other's work, and the collaboration can happen. Now, if you've prepared a video for delivering your content, or if you're planning to prepare a video, for the video editing, if you don't have access to desktop, you can use OpenShot or InShot or KineMaster, which are the applications that are available on Android. And this gives you an easy access to edit your videos which you have prepared by using your device. Another app or another option that you can use is for creating mind maps or concept maps. Say, for example, if you've studied certain concepts and if you want to summarize those concepts, if you want to note down some important points, you can draw simple mind maps or concept maps of the important concepts that you've studied by using the tools such as Mindomo, Minds, Mind Mapping 3D. These are some of the Android applications which are available, which gives you an opportunity to create the mind maps of the important concepts that you have studied. If you want to utilize certain quizzes, or if you want to take poll in your classroom, or if you want to set up certain small assignments, for that you can use Mentimeter or Google Form, which will be available along with your Google account, and you can set those form and share the link with your other peers or your students who can respond to those queries, those Google Forms, and we can see the responses of those Google Forms from your mobile device. Another thing that you can use for curating the content and bookmarking the content, either if you're working online or you're working offline. So here are some of the apps that you can use on your Android devices. You can use Microsoft OneNote or Evernote, which will help you to jot down the important points, make your own notes, organize the content, like if you want to say make a to-do list of the tasks that you have to do, that can be done using Evernote. So these are some of the suggested softwares or tools which can be used for Android devices. There are many other which can be explored. So these are some suggestions from our end. You can explore many other options too. Over to you, Vinita ma'am.
Thank you, Sunita. Okay, so there is another query from our faculty, Jitendra Gajpe, who is asking about a question that is, how do we incorporate detecting learning breakdown into online courses as was described in the TEDx talk on MAT versus MOOC? So this TEDx talk was provided as an LXT resource. And for some of you who may not have opted for this LXT resource, I would just give you a brief background on what it meant by learning background breakdowns. Learning breakdowns were explained as some of the times when students were not able to understand the concepts. So here, to answer your query, if you have seen the TEDx talk, there were some recommendations that were provided in the talk to actually be able to address these learning breakdowns. And these recommendations have been listed here. So the speaker said that you should have only one message, one takeaway per individual topic, which has been delivered. The second recommendation is implement active learning. Make learners do problem at the same time when you have told about the concept and not way later. Third is that there are so many learners in the discussion, in the course. So make them interact, provide them a facility to be able to learn from each other. And the fourth one is to motivate the learner through real world scenarios. So this particular question had also come up on the discussion forum, and I was waiting for someone else to respond, or, you know, as we progress through the course, for someone to realize that what is happening in the course itself. So if you see, the first recommendation is to actually chunk the course into smaller pieces, which is exactly our LEDs, one concept per LED. The second recommendation is implement active learning, which the course is doing through LBDs, that is immediate practice of the application after each concept. The third one is to be able to provide learners facility to interact with each other. So we have always been telling our learners to interact through our LXIs. And the fourth one is to motivate the learner through real world connections, which is contextualized learning, provide them examples in different contexts. As we have been doing, we have been attempting through our reflection spots in our LEDs. And we will also talk about this in our week three LEDs. In addition, we have been providing varied learning resources in multiple forms and content topics to cater to diverse learners through our LXTs, which is another way of addressing learning breakdowns. And this particular live interaction that is happening today to discuss learner queries, challenges, is yet another way to address those learning breakdowns.
No, that's fine. That's fine. I was going to bring it, the LEDs and all, but it's nice it's there on the slide itself. So the only thing is, so far you've been experiencing these different elements of this course, of this MOOC, the learning dialogues, the reflection spots. I'm sure you're all very familiar with, because that's where you've been asked to do something. As you're watching the video, what we'll do in the next 2 weeks is actually discuss about these a little bit more in terms of, if you had to design your own content, so how would you keep in mind, how would you try to avoid the learning breakdown for your students? How would you make it more learner-centric for your students in the online medium? So how do you design an LED and LBD, parts of this, not the entire thing, but little pieces of this, the core ideas, we will have you do for your own learners.
And about the course, learner-centric MOOC, if you want to learn more on that.
Yeah. So some of you may be aware of this, but I'm not sure. So let me just give a background. All of the parts, these aspects of the MOOC, especially the things that you see in red font on the slide, comes from a model called learner-centric MOOC model, or LCM model. So till last semester, there used to be an NPTEL course called Designing Learner-Centric MOOCs. And I think we'll offer it again next year. Right now, it's not running. But what is important for you to know is that this is all based in research on how to implement, how to design and implement effective learning for students and for adult learners in an online setting. And LCM model forms the core of it. So you'll see all these acronyms and these pieces. But essentially, the ideas, the main ideas are there on the slide.
I think there is a follow-up question on this, that how do we detect learning breakdown when it occurs? So I think one of the ways is through synchronous live interactions. I mean, learners have to come up with their learning breakdowns and discuss it with their peers and instructor.
Yeah.
Right.
So actually, this is an interesting question. It's a good question. This is by Mr. Rajesh Solanki. You're talking, so what Vinita and I had discussed till now is how to mitigate, how to try to avoid these learning breakdowns from happening. And we have to be very careful in the design side to do that. But what you're saying is right. Despite our best efforts, very likely some breakdown might happen. So we need to have some sort of diagnostic mechanisms to identify when these breakdowns pop up. And like Vinita said, there are a few things you can do both in synchronous and asynchronous. So if you have a live interaction like this, you can actually solicit either learners' alternate conceptions or, you know, the learning breakdowns or some difficulties and challenges they may have. You can use the discussion forum to solicit these. So for example, for every topic, what we do in our courses is for every topic, we ask learners to post what was the most difficult point or the muddiest point just before the next class or just at the end of this class, even in online classes. And how that helps is the instructor knows just before going into a live interaction what are challenges that learners are facing. And that is one place to diagnose the breakdown. So you can do this through the discussion forum or through Mentimeter or through this live chat in synchronous sessions. Surita, is there anything you want to add with respect to, you know, you've been a student of the online courses also. So what has helped you in, what successful things have the instructors done in order to diagnose such learning breakdowns?
Okay, so as ma'am mentioned, being a student of such online learning courses, what has helped me as a student was, there's a focus question which has been posted on the discussion forum, and the discussion happens alongside or in the periphery of that focus question. So the learners have a focus question to think upon, and it is not like that every question has been answered by the instructor, but instead the questions are being answered by the peers. The peers, they give their own opinions about the question, then there comes a follow-up question. So one person is discussing one aspect of it, the other person may bring in some other perspective of it. So there's a healthy discussion which is happening, and that helps in learning.
Okay, thanks, Sunita. Yeah.
All right. So hopefully we addressed that question. Moving on to the next one. This is from Purnima Rabindran, who's asking approximately how much time does it take to design effective e-learning content? For example, a textbook chapter. Will it be an ongoing process always?
So, okay, the easy part is to say, yes, it is an ongoing process, okay? See, when you say time-wise, no, rather than give you a numerical response, I think what is good to do is to think of it in terms of what are the various aspects when you need to design e-learning content. No, you have to conceptualize it, which means you have to do the chunking, you have to look at the textbook chapter. Even within a chapter, there's a lot of chunking to be done. If you need to assemble slides or create visuals, you have to do that. If you feel that some topic is explained well in some external resource or there's an animation, you have to curate that content. So this conceptualizing and assembling is one part of it. Then if you choose to record your own video content, we are assuming that you have learned the tools and the basic tools and techniques beforehand. So that is a major part where you have to record and edit. And these days, especially after the pandemic, most instructors are doing home recording and home editing. So there are several tools and strategies available. And in week one, we also gave you some links to the online teaching course to do it. So that takes significant time. after that, the time you have to spend, it doesn't end there. You know, as classroom instructors, somehow we feel that, okay, now that we've created the video, that's the end. It doesn't end there. But we have to share the content, upload it, and monitor what's happening. So that entire loop has to be closed. So for example, if some content is uploaded and there is some learner difficulty, that has to be addressed. So I think what you can do is just think in terms of these aspects. And in the beginning, some of this will take a lot of time. The chunking and the conceptualizing you're familiar with as experienced instructors, but now the medium is different. So the extra time will have to be spent thinking of how to do it well in this new medium. The video recording and editing is actually new. So sometimes that itself takes a lot of time initially. What we recommend is, especially during these emergency times, it's okay if your production quality is reasonably good. You know, we are not expecting that everybody is in a studio setting and all that. Try to get something reasonably good, try to get the visuals that you need and move on, because a lot of things you can address during the orchestration phase. So I know I didn't answer your question in terms of the number of hours, but that really depends on your experience level as a teacher overall, your comfort with the medium, your experience with the medium, and the latter part does improve. But yeah, having said this, if you spend some, let's say, 3:1 time, you know, for a 1 hour class, let's say you spend 3 to 4 hours preparing in a face-to-face setting. This is initially at least twice, 2 to 3 times to begin with, you know. So we have had instructors saying that for let's say a 10-minute equivalent of content, they would spend even like 7-8 times that much time. You know, 1:10 is also not surprising. But it does become better, especially if you put the whole thing together.
Yeah. Just to add one point, I think it also depends on an individual, how much of breadth and depth we are covering. For the same topic, I may spend 4 hours and another person may end up spending 10. And the refinement that you keep on doing. So for example, for this course, we ran this course last year, but this year we have done quite some revisions, you know. So because we wanted to improve on what we had created according to the context that we all are in today. So I think, yeah, it also depends on how you want to take it up.
I think there's a follow-up to that maths question, the last one there.
Yeah. So doesn't a learner breakdown prevent further learning? That was the point behind it. Doesn't the learner breakdown prevent further learning?
See, learner breakdowns could occur.
Bound to happen.
Okay, because at some level, whenever anybody, any learner is encountering new material and trying to assimilate it, especially if it's what's called complex learning, challenges will happen, these breakdowns will happen. But what we want to avoid is that we want to avoid it completely putting a hold on the learning. So we want to minimize it and we want to have strategies to address it and mitigate it if it happens. So we want diagnostic mechanisms that if we feel some sort of breakdown is imminent, we want to try to catch it and sort of bring things back. So the strategies, the recommendations in the MAIT were also towards that. In fact, those were towards trying to, I don't want to use the word prevent, because it's not like we can always prevent it, but trying to minimize those. Now, so we need strategies on both, you know, we need prevention as well as redress. So that's the two-part answer that we gave. I was actually talking about the one where, if you're using Google Meet and sharing PowerPoint slides, you can't use pen or you can't write. What to do at that point? So, you want to talk about tablets and all that?
I'm using Google Meet and sharing my PPT to my class, but I can't use pen, show, or write on slide. My subject is business mathematics.
Yeah. So Sunita has given one response here. She's saying try using Liveboard interactive whiteboard app. And the thing is, you need some other tool, okay, in addition to slides. You can either use some sort of whiteboard app that allows you on mobile, or if you want to sort of, if you need to do a lot of writing in your course, okay, if that's the way you want to go it. What some of our colleagues have done is purchased one of the low-end tablets, like the Wacom tablets and all, and have connected it to do it. Okay. There is a bit of an investment there, but if the primary mode for you is writing, then you may, you know, a tablet is perhaps the way to go. You don't need like a very high-end tablet or something. And we can post a link to, you know, which tablet can be bought and all. We can post a link in the discussion forum afterwards.
We can also share some of the like Jamboard and interactive whiteboards which are available for free. So we'll do that one.
So these are tools which can be used in live sessions and even otherwise. But it's really a call you have to take, you know, are they sufficient for you, the whiteboard apps and all? Or do you really, you know, if you want to record, for example, if you want to record a lot of derivations, how do you do it? We work with both. You know, we've worked with whiteboards like this as well as gone for the tablet mode. And when the volume becomes a lot, then perhaps a tablet is easier to do. Yeah, there is a somebody suggested a Wacom, one of the Wacom models. Yeah. That's what a lot of our colleagues are also using.
Yeah. Okay. So there is another question from a student. It's a generic question where Parvati is asking, what is your take on the digital divide in India in the context of COVID-19 and online classes?
That's a big question. Are you logged in, Parvati? If so, you know, if you're logged in, we'll just wait for a minute and see if you have anything specific to ask here. So our advice to ourselves as teachers and our own students and our colleagues is breathe a little bit, take it a little easy, in the sense what we're seeing is that there's a lot of overwhelm. It's not just the online learning which is new now. It's the stress of the pandemic, it's this lack of peer support, lack of socialization. So for our students, that is becoming a very big problem. And these are students in higher ed. They're not even going to school level students. So if you're a teacher, I know you're a student, but if you're a teacher, what we would say is try to see how you can reduce the overwhelm for your students. If it means you cover a little less material, that's okay. That's really okay in these times. If it means you can support your learners in some way, some additional way, do it. For our students, what we are saying is try your best to get peer support. So we have small WhatsApp groups in our courses, which the students manage on their own. And if somebody is solving an assignment at 10 p.m., you know, they just post on that group saying, oh, I'm doing this assignment, anybody else is logged on. And whoever else is logged on is there. So creating these small group networks is very important. It is overwhelming, it is stressful. We have to get through it. If that's something you're facing, you know, everybody will, yeah, at least remember that a lot of people are going through this. You want to share anything from your daughter's schoolwork related to this?
I think we come from one of the privileged, you know, ones. So yes, a lot of work is coming and they are handling MS Teams, and there are families who do not have, they have two children, three children, and are not able to do it on individual laptops. So they are somehow managing on mobile phones, and it is difficult. I was reading an article the other day where I read about this person who had to sell his cow to buy a phone of 6,000 so that his child could attend online classes. So as ma'am said, it is definitely difficult, and being aware of it is the first step.
Yeah. Even things like, if your students typically stay in residential hostels like in our institute, and now everybody is at home. The home conditions might not be conducive to learning. I mean, you know, students might not have, or maybe there are two or three siblings in the same room and multiple classes are happening. So as a teacher, just be aware of all of this. As a student, do the best you can. Try to find the peer support. We don't know the answers, you know, honestly. Everybody is in this together. The best we can do, the point of this course is, since all of us have to jump into, all of us instructors have to jump into online teaching, what are some good practices we can put in for the design? How to prevent, you can say, learning breakdowns, or how to make sure learning engagement is better? Don't do 1 hour lecture videos. Don't even do 20 minutes straight long lecture videos. Do very tiny pieces, intersperse it, make it available asynchronously. These are the standard recommendations, and we'll keep coming back to that.
There is another question from Rajesh R. I am not sure if I understand the question as such. It says pre-engagement 4 to 8 units of time, live engagement 1 unit, post-engagement 4 to 8 units is the time we spend. Your comments. So I'm not sure if I understand the specific question here.
The only abstract thing I can take away from this question is that we need to spend time, sufficient time, pre-engagement, during the live engagement, post-engagement. Definitely, we agree with that. Exactly how much time, you know, that is something, it's not a prescription here. But at the same time, we also want to say that think about the asynchronous medium. This is not a very popular opinion. I know everybody wants live engagement, but those are tiring for the instructor and for the students. Imagine a student taking 6 courses, 6 papers, as they say in university settings, in a semester. Each one has live interactions every day of the week. It's very tiring. So make short information content available for asynchronous use. That goes a long way in reducing this asymmetry, or reducing these challenges.
Right. So next question is from a faculty, Raghunathan Rajesh, and he's asking, can you suggest specific online platforms, tools which can be used where significant group interactions and discussions are possible? So Sunita will take this question. So Sunita, can you please brief on this?
Sure, sure. So I get your question, sir. Group work or interaction between peers is very important. And one such way or one such tool which can help you do so is Miro. So I'll be explaining you about this tool, how it can be used. So as you can see on the screen, this is Miroboard, which is a collaborative tool where a group of students can collaborate with each other and perform the activities. So this is the interface of the Miroboard. You can see on the left-hand side, there are multiple options, such as you can select an object, you can choose a template as a background for your Miro board. You can add text to it. You can add sticky notes, and you can choose different sticky notes. So as well as that, you can also draw. There's an autocorrective drawing tool which helps you to draw the content that you desire to draw. You can also comment on other people's content which they have chosen. So this makes it easier to collaborate. So if one person is posting something on the Miro board and the other person has something to say about it or to add to that, they can comment onto it. There's also an option of uploading the files in the Miro board. So you can either upload the files from your device itself, or you can give a URL link which will embed the particular content on your Miro board. There's an option on the top right side that you can share, that you can see. There's a share option on the screen. Here you can add the collaborators which can collaborate together on the Miro board. So it could be a group of 4 to 5 people or even more than that. And all the collaborators will be visible in the Miro board. There's also an option where the collaborators, they can chat with each other. They can ask questions or they can talk to each other. there are some options which are available for a temporary period of time, such as the trial period of, say, 14 days, which Miro won't offer. So these options include video chat, where the collaborators can video chat with each other, or they can vote to each other's content. These are temporary options, but there are some options which will be available throughout, such as the chat, comments, and screen share options. You can also see the activity history. So for example, if you are editing the Miro board right now, and you take a break for some time and then again join the Miro board after some time, and you see that the Miro board had changed drastically. So you don't know what are the changes which have occurred, and you don't know what are the changes which other collaborators have made. So you can always see the activity history, and you get a track of what the other collaborators have added to the Miro board. You can take some notes for yourself, as you can see on the right hand side. You can say take some notes, you can make your own to-do list, you can add your meeting agendas, and so on. Can you please go to the next slide, Vinita ma'am?
Yeah.
So here's a worked example of using Miro board. Now here I have used three different colors of sticky notes. Say T1, T2, and T3 are three different collaborators who are working on the same Miro board. And then I have added an image. Say T1, who's the team member one, has added an image which depicts the process of photosynthesis. And someone else wants to ask a question. So he or she can comment it by using the comment function, which you can see on the screen. So the another person has made a comment like, can you please explain it? Now this way, multiple people can work together on this Miro board. They can collaborate with each other, they can comment on each other's work, and the discussion can go on. So that's one way how you can establish discussion between your peers by using Miro board. Over to you, Vinita ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, Sunita. Okay, so we have one more question from faculty, Mahajani, who's asking that for engineering courses, syllabus completion looks very difficult in stipulated duration with methods of learner engagement. Please guide. Over to you.
Yeah. So your point is absolutely valid. And I think somebody on chat had also earlier said that, you know, syllabus and content also need to be reduced and more time needs to be given along with the suggestions. So I think we all need to do this, and we need to get the management, the college management on board. I'm sure the students will be on board. So if any of you are, any of you are logged in, or any of you in this course are principals or heads of departments or deans or so, please take this very seriously, especially during these times, because there really, we don't really have any other option. And if, see, the thing is, suppose we say we are going to complete the syllabus as teachers. We know this even in the face-to-face scenarios, that as teachers, we can just go and lecture everything. But does it mean that the students really learn? That question is always there. The question, the implications of that question are magnified now, because it's not just about learning or lack of learning, or engagement or lack of engagement. It's also, you know, the time management, mental health, physical health, all of this. So, in the best case, if you are in an autonomous institute, or if you have any control over your class, go along this direction. Try to see if you can do what's required as a prerequisite for the next course. And anything additional, you put it in LXTs, put it as additional reading. If you are, you know, if you need to go and talk to the head of your department and principal and tell them that, look, this is absolutely essential, please do it, spend that much time. So that's sort of the best we can suggest at this point.
Okay. Yeah. So one question that came in later, and we could not put in here, is from Dr. Sampa Chakraborty, and she's asking that I teach through Google Meet using PowerPoint slides. How can I make slides interactive with immediate feedback? So there are a lot of interactive features available in PowerPoint itself,
And we have later on in the later part of the presentation, we have collated all of those software and tools together. So probably we will just glance through them later, and we will also provide the software resources as maybe an NXT or just a resource for you to look at. So I think that takes care of this one. We don't have any question live here. So we had some interesting conversations going on the discussion forum, and we thought of bringing them up here so that all of us get aware of what is happening in the discussion forum and look at some of these interesting conversations. So KM Raghavendran, he shared his findings from a survey that he took in class, and amongst the findings, two of them particularly interesting that connected to our week two content was about chunking and how the students have realized that they are not happy with longer videos and they want shorter video lectures. And the question here is that I am not sure how to make those kind of MOOCs, so I joined this course. So as ma'am said, designing learner-centric MOOC is another course that our team is offering. So maybe you can enroll for that as well. Not this time, not this semester, but it will be up maybe next semester.
Add on that. So thank you very much, Mr. Raghavendran, for your observation, I mean, your sharing of the survey findings, because this is what, you know, has been coming out of raw empirical data, even if these are not like, you know, very, even if they're in individual classes and all. And this is what is being recommended throughout the points that you have mentioned. The only caveat I wanted to add is, see, we really like these MOOCs that are there on Swayam or Coursera and Udacity and all, but we need to keep in mind the, you know, the pedagogical design of it, which is what this course is trying to, those are the recommendations in this course, and the production. So those, anything done on these large platforms will be in high quality production studios with a large team and so on, even during these times, even during the lockdown times. So let's not attempt to go to that level of production. Let's just keep those different. We will do a clean visual design, use the best tools that we can, and if it's a webcam and the, you know, the headphone and mic set that comes with our cell phones, in as much as a noise free environment as we can, that's the best. We won't get up to that studio level of visual and you know, production quality design. Don't worry about it. Don't even aim for that. That's the only point I wanted to make here. But the points you've made regarding the length and the materials being shared prior to class, online submission happening on a piece of paper, taking a photo and uploading it, all these work. Yeah? So please continue.
So on the point of chunking here, this, I hope it is visible. Another learner, KG Krishna, has, I think it was yesterday, when he was talking about chunking, and he said that I fully agree with the process of chunking, but in some concepts like long mathematical analysis, it becomes difficult to break that trail of logic, and students have to invariably have long attention spans, and this is where I always get into the conflict with generic demand of making your videos not more than 10 minutes kind of directive. And he asks for your opinion. So, I mean, maybe I'll go.
Go ahead.
Okay. Yeah. And then, so I'll just quickly show that there has been a study where MIT researchers and edX has come up with this video engagement analysis, which shows that 6 minutes to 9 minutes is the range where, you know, attention span actually stays, and then there is a sharp decrease after that. Since you were talking about mathematical concepts, we also went ahead and, you know, found some research papers So this is a paper where a problem-based video podcast was designed to teach mathematical concepts. And these concepts are for pre-calculus. And one of the major things that they have been talking here is the length of the video. So in the design features also, they did mention that you should keep your length of the video between 7 to 8 minutes, not more than that, to address the issues of limited attention span. So, I mean, although we agree that it is difficult sometimes, but not all diverse learners will be able to maintain that attention span for such a long time of, you know, 30 minutes or more. So just to have to be aware of that, I would say will be recommended. But on your opinion.
Yeah, so let's look at it from both sides. Okay, Vinita has given lots of argument from the side of learners' attention span. But, you know, you're an instructor, you say, look, this topic demands it. So one question you can ask yourself is, okay, maybe I can't do it in 7 or 8 minutes, but how much do I really need to go? And I think there's a big difference between, say, 10 minutes and 40 minutes. You know, so if you can't do it in 7 or 8 or 10 minutes, can you do it in 16 minutes? And when we say do it, so think about the logical pause points that you would do. Let's say you had a 1 hour class and you had a derivation that went on for 45 minutes. There would be a point where, you know, there is a pause point. It's not like the derivation is over, but you would have written something, you'd have been explaining a set of logic, and there's a point where you say, okay, now we need to connect it to that, this other, some other theorem, bring it in and go ahead. So any such pause point in between, try to identify it. Or a point where you might ask the learner a question, or you might even just ask them, am I clear so far? You know, you would do it at a point where there is some sort of a breathing space. That is one place where you can break the video. The other thing you can do is, let's say your derivation is going on for 20 minutes in the video. Insert like 3 or 4 reflection spots. Okay. But if you have a single monologue derivation for 40 or 45 minutes, that's what all these research is saying. I mean, nobody's stopping you from doing it, but what they say is that learners are not going to watch it. So that is the price that we have to accept if we go ahead. Yeah.
Okay. So we have seen a lot of e-learning challenges that have been suggested by you all on the forum. And all of them are valid e-learning challenges. Here, we have tried to collate some of them, which have been talked about. And the first one is about student engagement. Rajesh R. Talked about, you know, how the student engagement was different in classroom setting and now how it is different in online setting. And he asked about understanding the ways to improve them. So up here, KG Krishna came up with some of the ways, some of the practices that he has been talking about. And those practices actually linked our principles that we have also been talking about, and we will be talking about more in our course, such as personalization, interaction with the content, increased learner ownership, and incentivization. So apart from that, there are some more strategies that we would want to talk about while worrying about online engagement, that is to provide them opportunities to immediately apply the learned concepts, as we have talked about earlier, and giving them activities through which they can link the presented content to their previous experiences. Many are looking for increasing online engagement. Okay, so
Another major challenge that you all have been talking about is catering to learner diversity. So one question that has come up is, can I use interactive online class for learners who are less interested to attend regular classes and avoid to submit assignments during this time?
Yeah, can you use interactive?
So he's saying that there are some students who do not want to submit assignments, but they're interested in doing interactive sessions. So is it okay when we are doing online classes to go, you know, out of the box and just conduct interactive sessions for them and cater to such diverse learners who are not interested in regular lecture assignment kind of scenario?
If you want to break the some standard setting, I think if you follow the principles still, you see if you can follow the principles but go do create and design different types of instruction. So the part which we discussed earlier also today, that make sure that there is immediate practice, lots of frequent practice. Can you make that happen in your new model? Or how can you make that happen in your new model? That should be the question. It's okay if you do a lot of interactive sessions, but will they get practice where they do things on their own? So those kind of principles, if you can apply, or in your new model, can you somehow foster, facilitate peer learning a lot more? So those are the kind of questions you have to ask yourself. And these are all really design problems. You know, there are some principles, basic principles, which come from how do students learn effectively. And then we apply these and actually design various instructional, design various instruction. So it can be materials, it can be these kind of interactive sessions and so on.
And we will be covering some aspects of addressing diversity in our week 3, where we'll talk about how different formats of interactions can be used, how different formats of resources, like you are getting different LXT resources, can be used, multiple representations, examples to be provided in different contexts for diverse learners. All this we will be covering in our week 3 content.
I'm just going back to the previous point, okay? When you said that they don't like submitting assignments, maybe you can play around with the format of the assignments. You know, for example, if you find learners are not able to write down problems and submit them, can you have them videotape themselves, you know, explaining something and upload the short video? Can you have them create a concept map, collaborative concept map on Miro board, like Sunita explained, and have them submit a link to the Miro board? So play around with the format of the assignments also. Sometimes, you know, that might actually help. Because if it's the same type of assignment where they're given a problem, they have to write and write and write and then submit and there's too much time, just a novel format, which is meaningful, of course, but also doable in this medium. So because now everybody's online, everybody has internet connection and a phone. However, you don't have to have a very high-end phone or connection, but it's there. So having students explain something, videotape it and uploading it, maybe students will enjoy that. So yeah.
Another challenge that has been talked about is learner motivation. And here you all have been talking about self-motivation for the learner, which is intrinsic. It is of course a challenge in online learning, and we can only address this challenge of intrinsic, you know, student motivation to a certain extent. And we talk about certain strategies on how to engage learner through meaningful learning, you know, in week 3, by how we can make them construct their own learning or contextualize learning, connect to the real world problems. As ma'am just said, group activities, collaboration, peer learning. So I think these are some of the ways, and we will talk about them in week 3. Other than that, a wholesome learner engagement, intrinsic motivation, Can we do anything more on that from our end? Yeah. So, okay. Moving on. There are certain challenges which I think awareness is the key, which have been brought up, you know, challenges in rural areas, the wide gap that we just talked about. So as we said, we don't have all the answers here, but we're aware of such challenges.
Yeah, for it's specifically for this challenge that you see that too many live synchronous sessions are not recommended, because live synchronous sessions need heavy bandwidth and the flexibility is lost. Students have to come at that time. They may have to go to an internet cafe or something which is far away and all that. So short and small file sized content uploaded with student somewhere where students can download when they have internet connection, that is sort of the first stage you can, if even that is too much. So I've not done this myself, but I'm using this for a course. There are videos available, but the instructor also uploads the audio recording and the slides separately. So the file sizes become even smaller. And there is not, this is in a course where, you know, the visuals are mostly the slides. There isn't any heavy graphics. So these are alternate media formats. Go with a lot of text and still images. And if you do want to keep the, keep sort of a communication going, upload the audio, you know, that's one way. But even with video, it's possible now with a lot of software to make small file sizes. If even so, that needs to be done. This is an absolute must. It needs to be done. Suppose you in your area, even that is not possible. Okay, let's say you know your students. It's a small class and all. Can you make the material available on SD cards or pen drives and somehow mail it to students? One of our colleagues did that. In fact, he's teaching a lab course and he made these small kits. 50 of them, because he has 50 students in his course. It had a microprocessor, it had a lot of things except the oscilloscope, which is required. You know, you can't mail that. And he and his lab staff, they actually mailed it out to 50 students in 28 states. And now students, so a lab course is happening in this online mode. Every week they get together and some instructions are given and students build it at home, they take some data and then they upload the results on the Moodle learning management system. So this point of mailing SD cards, also somebody else, I've heard it from somebody else. So see what media and what processes can be done and then try to adapt your instruction to those.
Okay, so there was one question on the discussion forum which talked about a best platform or tool for something, and the response was given, and I really like the response that, you know, there is not one best tool. We can provide you a list of tools, and I'm sorry, you have to customize it for your own use. So we are presenting here a list of tools and
the link that you see here, okay, it's a self-paced course on how to teach online, and it's available on Google Sites. The link is right up here. So on one of the resources provided there is actually a comparison of the various tools that you can use for recording and editing, audio editing, only editing, and the features and the characteristics, the learning curve, the subscription models, all this is given on it. So if you want to choose tools, if you want to get a feel for the tools, just go and view this. Take the link down and feel free to look at the various parts of this course. It's a very
huge set of resources for content creation and editing. And if you are doing a lot of it this semester, this year, this resource would be useful.
And we will put this deck of PPT on the course, so you can go at your convenience, go through them. So Sunita, you want to talk quickly about this, or should I move on?
Okay. We can move on.
Okay. So this is the last slide that we have. Somebody had asked a question that, is it necessary to participate in a weekly LXI? And this is the response that I put up there. And I just wanted to emphasize on this response that LXIs that we have designed is for peer learning. And you know, it is a great way in which you can learn from the community of learners that are there in the course. And there is very good discussion going on, but please keep it moving. Week 2 LXI is out there. So keep your interactions going.
Okay, that's great. Thanks. There's one last comment, and I think this is valuable. It's from Rajesh R. It says that Kerala is doing an on-air education through the Victor's channel. That's right. So they have combined Facebook and YouTube, where the content is being delivered. Actually, one more point with this Victor's is that it's the teachers themselves who are creating the content. So there's a lot of buy-in because it's the same community of teachers who are doing it. And all the support is, a lot of the support is actually through WhatsApp groups. So it's, you know, a very community-based solution for online teaching and learning. It's none of this studio setting, and you know, it's not a top-down setting. So you can take a look at those models. But essentially, any electronic tools, digital tools that we have for communication and for sharing content, see how you can adapt it for your setting. It may be just one class. It can be your university or your college. Or the Victor's is actually a statewide government program. So it's being done at scale also.
Okay. So
nice.
Yeah.
Interacting with all of you.
We'll see you after 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Bye. Thanks, Sunita.
Yeah. Thank you.
Ravi? Yeah.
Stop.
I don't know. I think for 1 or 2 years, it's okay. And 1 more year, so.